Okay, everyone. We're going to get started. All you people who want to be warmer, we're going to get started. So I'm Susie Enos. Together with my husband, Dave, we'll be your presenters tonight. We are not professional installation installers. We sort of tagged this event as Neighbors Helping Neighbors. What we have been doing is, for the last 10 or 15 years, volunteering with environmental organizations that help you reduce your carbon footprint, which in this case means keeping your house warmer and lowering your energy bills. Tonight's event has been sponsored by the Bedford Energy Task Force, which is a town board appointed by the selectmen to help the town save money and reduce its energy use, and also by Transition Town Bedford, which is a local community group that works on community resilience, local food, local jobs, local energy. Also with us tonight, we have some folks from Next Step Living, Anna and Marie, and they're going to be available during our hands-on session to talk about getting a mass save audit, which is an awesome way to understand your current insulation assessment. And also thank you to Bedford TV, who's joining us today to tape the event. It's going to be up on their website, so if you have a neighbor who is really sad they missed this event, they can watch it later on the internet. Okay, so let's get started. What are we going to talk about today? So everyone's insulation challenge can be a little bit different. So what I want to make sure that you leave with today is an understanding of the basic concepts around how you're going to solve any particular insulation problem. Then we'll look at some very specific materials, applications, costs, installation costs for a number of different ways to insulate your house. We'll talk about some take-home actions. I'm going to give you some actions that you can do this week to make your house warmer. There are some resources if you want to move on to a bigger project. We'll talk about some resources that can support you in that. We'll have some questions, and then we'll move on to the hands-on section. Dave has built this wonderful movable feast of insulation, where we can talk about, you know, many different ways that we can meet the challenge of your specific house or your specific project. So what are we trying to do with insulation? So the goal here is that you want to keep your house at the proper temperature. And that could be cool in the summer or warm in the winter. And everything that we talk about today, it's the same value for winter or summer. Because it's now snowing outside, we'll probably use the terms about keeping your house warm, but insulation provides the same value for both. And there's two ways to get there. One is to continuously generate that heat or cold to keep your house at the right temperature, and the other way is to provide insulation so that heat does not leave your house. Since no one has solved the free energy problem, we're going to focus on point number two, which is the best return on investment for keeping your house warmer. It's providing more insulation and making sure the heat that you generate does not leave your house. So let's first talk about heat transfer. So on the left here, you can see a pot of boiling water. You've got the burner that's heating up the pot. The pot's heating up the water. The water's cooking the pasta. And you've got a wooden spoon across the top. So what would happen if you went to pick up that pot with the metal handles? You would probably not be happy. You'd probably burn your hands. And that's because I think you already know a lot about heat transfer. You know that the heat's going to go from the pot to the metal handles, and it's going to be really hot. And so you would know, I need an insulator to pick that up. You've got a wooden spoon. If the wooden spoon was sticking in the boiling water, you probably know it's okay to pick up that wooden spoon. And that's because you sort of know that wood is an insulator compared to the pot. So you already have a lot of knowledge about what's an insulator, what transfers heat or cold. So think about that when you think about your house. So in the lower right here, you see a picture. This is an infrared picture of a house. And the way it works is the red means that it's hot right there. The blue means it's cold. And you can see the range of colors moving through green, yellow, up to red. So when you look at this picture, you can see certain areas of the house are warm. So what areas are warm? Windows, doors. And you can see also
that red is warm.
Red is warm. Yeah, so those are the parts of the house that are warm. And what that means is the house itself isn't warm. You put heat in that house, and now it's leaving the house. And you can see where it's leaving the house. It's leaving the house in those red spots. So that's heat transfer. And when you think about heat transfer, you're thinking about, how am I going to stop those places where heat is leaving? And it's interesting to think about, if you look, oh, I have a pointer. Let me use my pointer. If you think about this spot where it's hot at the top of the house here, think about a layer of snow on that roof. Up here where it's hot, that snow is going to melt, and the water is going to run down till it hits this very blue part, which is very cold, and it's going to freeze. This is how you get a heat dam. The way you solve, I mean, heat dam, an ice dam. The way you solve an ice dam problem is by properly insulating your roof or your attic so that the whole roof structure is the same temperature and there's no melting and refreezing and causing a problem. So we can see some parts are transferring heat, some parts are not transferring heat. There's a measure of heat transfer, and this is something you might have heard before, an R value. You'll see this on a lot of the materials that you're looking at in an insulation area. So here's an R value of wood, it's 0.7. So that's not a very good number. If you think about houses that are built today, a brand new house built today probably has a wall structure that's maybe an R25 or an R30. If it's built to a super insulation standard, that's about an R40. So when you look at some of these numbers, 0.71, not very good. A window, you know, even less. So those are where you're going to struggle to resist the heat that wants to move out. And so there's a lot of detail here, but you can just see some of the common items that are used to insulate. You've got the fiberglass bat, that's often in pink. You'll see some of that here. Blown-in cellulose, polyurethane, which is the foaming in place, or maybe some foil-backed foam. All different ways to keep the heat inside your house.
Yes, but those values don't tell you how thick it is.
So these values are per inch. So so if you have, for instance, the average thickness of a bat is usually 6.5 inch. You can buy them in a lot of different, and that's the normal R19. So if you go and buy the pink fiberglass, you're usually buying an R19. So this is just per inch so that you can evaluate. Let's say you only have an inch left to insulate and you need a high number. This helps you decide what you're gonna choose. So the materials are a piece of the answer, but a lot of the answer is the design as well. So let's look at two designs. So you've got two different wall constructions. The one here on the left is pretty common for an older house. You've got brick on the outside. Anybody know what the R value of brick is? Not very good. It's like a 1. Then you've got some wood. We know we don't like wood. Then you've got your 2x4, and then you've got your plasterboard on the inside, also a sub-1 value. You've got your insulation in the bay. So now let's think, if I'm heat and I'm trying to leave your house, how am I going to leave the house? It's a little bit like water. It's going to seek its own level. It's going to say, you know what, I can go right across here with a thermal bridge. I'm going to take a thermal bridge right to the outside. That's the challenge with some of the older construction. Some of the newer construction has some additional benefits. So in this example, there's a wall cavity, a sealed air wall cavity, and insulated sheathing that protects as a thermal barrier completely between the brick and the wood on the inside. So now, where here we had a bridge, here what we have is a barrier. And it's a complete barrier, so there's no simple path. I mean, you still, once you get to the other side, obviously this is going to be easier than this, but you've sort of broken that thermal bridge that existed. So if we think about our wall picture that we had before, here's a picture of another house. What can you see here?
All the studs.
Yeah, all the studs. So here you can see, you know, the yellow is more heat than the green in between, and what you can see is the thermal bridge that has been provided directly by contacting all those materials together and coming straight out. So it's great that you're doing the insulation, but you need to be thinking about what is that path that my heat is trying to use to leave. So now you understand bridging, you understand thermal barriers. Now I have a quiz. So I don't know if anyone recognizes this house. This is a house in Lexington. It was featured in this old house maybe, I don't know, 10 years ago. And it was interesting at the time because it was built with reused girders from the upper deck. So they reclaimed the I-beams and they used them in the construction of the house. They used them to support the roof of the house. And they had the bars going in cement and then straight into the living area. And you could see it on the inside, very interesting. Oh, look, our reclaimed upper deck. So can anyone see any problem with that?
It's ugly.
Aside from that. Exactly. So they have just built a huge thermal bridge that's going to take the cold. I mean, imagine a really cold day, and it's going to take that cold right into the house. So, you know, it's very interesting, but in terms of what they're doing for insulating the house, you know, maybe not so good. So, you know, these are really the concepts I want to make sure you understand, because when you think about your own project at home, if you understand a thermal bridge, you know, a thermal barrier, these are all important things to help you. As well as insulation, you need to think about air movement. So these are the two important concepts. So if the window's open in a winter day, that's R0. That's just, you know, heat just leaving. Same if it's any crack. So a lot of us live in older houses, you know, that were built in a different time. And before they had house wrap and, you know, all these other technologies. And any crack is a way for the heat to move directly out. If you think about some poorly insulated homes, you know, they can do these tests with a blower door to understand how tight your house is and how much leakage there is. And a lot of houses, it's the equivalent of having a window open all winter, because the house is not tight. There's air movement going through. So think about this. So you've got your house. It's nice and warm. It's you know, a little bit more conditioned air than probably what's outside in winter, so maybe it's got a little bit moisture in. And when it moves outside, when it moves through the crack, when it tries to level itself with the cold air that's outside, it's taking your heat and it's taking your moisture. And it's moving through whatever path it can find to get out there. That's an issue. I mean, it's become more concerning lately. People are worried about mold, rot, mildew. This is because the moisture is moving through those cracks. And it's bringing that moisture into your walls, into your insulation. If you have some, maybe it's now degrading that insulation. You need to think about how that moving air is going to affect your solution for insulation. So newer houses, they actually are sealed against air. And some of the insulation options provide an air seal. Many do not. So it's good to think about that when you're considering what are your insulation options. You might see air sealing done with a Tyvek like house wrap. You might see the green board over there is called zip board. That actually provides a vapor barrier if you tape all the seams once it's out in the house. That's pretty common. You can also use spray foam is an air sealer. So there's a number of solutions for air sealing. When you really get good at air sealing, then you have to think about, oh, how am I getting fresh air into my house? So there's two things to think about. If you're just doing some of the homeowner tips I'm going to give you for air sealing, you probably don't need to worry about that. Dave and I recently completed a super insulation project, and so we had to actually purchase an HRV, an air conversion device, to keep a number of air changes, bringing fresh air into the house. So a lot of things to balance when you're thinking about insulation. Okay, so we've got all our concepts down. Now let's move to the details. So I'm going to talk about four different types of insulation. So this is the one you might see most common, which was the BATS. And as the gentleman in the front brought up earlier, there's an R per inch, but then there's how big is what you normally buy. So 6.5 inch is normally what you'll see in a roll. You'll see R19 on it. And that's the value of the thickness that's available. The cost per square foot of an R19 is about 40 cents a square foot, and based on there's a resource that I'm going to give you as a link in the presentation about where you can see how much installed costs are. It's about $1.52 including an install if you wanted to have somebody install that for you. The challenges with this is it's not really full coverage. I mean, you've got your 2x4s or your 2x6s, and you're putting your insulation in there, and it's got some tabs that you're going to nail down, but it's not really a good seal. It can get compressed, you know, moisture can make it shrink. It's not really full coverage as some other solutions, and it's certainly not an air barrier. You have to worry about moisture, and you have to have access to the bays. So if you've got an unfinished attic, that's great, but if you want to get some into your walls and you don't want to pull off your plasterboard, it's not a great solution. It's good for unfinished spaces, it's good for attics, and out of a lot of the items we'll talk about today, it's, you know, homeowners could do this. You don't have to hire a professional. So that's one option, and it's probably, you know, one of the older technologies that's out there. The next option, this is blown-in insulation. And you can see, here's what it looks like when it's new construction. So on the inside, you'll actually put up some netting, you'll make a hole, and you'll blow the insulation through the netting into your bays. This is what it looks like on a remodel. So your house is already built. You access the bays from externally. You access it through the shingles on the outside, and your plasterboard on the other side is what it's bumping up against, and you blow it in from the outside in. And then if you're in the attic, you can just do free-for-all. Just blow, fill it up, make it nice and fluffy. So there's a number of different ways to use it. It's interesting that the cost per square foot of the materials is lower than the fiberglass, but the cost installed is higher. So it's typically a little bit more labor. It's going to give you a better coverage, probably, than your fiberglass bat, but it's still not getting you what we consider full coverage. You still have to worry about an air barrier. You still have to worry about moisture, and you still have to have access to your bays, whether it's from the outside or from the inside. It's good for completed spaces. This is probably the most popular item if your house is finished and you want to add insulation after that. Most of the blown-in insulation is fire-resistant, made from recycled newspaper, so, you know, some good stuff, but also good for attics. I'll call this a handy homeowner install. Dave and I have installed this previously, but you need to have, well, one of us needed to have more skills than the average homeowner to do that install.
So you have to rent the equipment?
We rented the equipment. We rented the blower. You get a big tight bag of the cellulose, you break it up, you throw it into a hopper, and then it blows where you need to go. So the question is, what would you like your R value to be? So we know that it's 3 or 4 R value per inch. So super insulation, you'd want an R60 in your ceiling or your attic. Average might be a 40 or a 50 for a new house. So you'd make the decision on what your goal is and what you had space for. Yeah, just keep going till it's full. Spray-in insulation. So now we're moving up in the cost bracket. We're also moving up in the features available. So two types really, open cell, closed cell, and you can see that there's some very strong differences between the two. One's almost double the R value of the other. One is good for an air barrier only at 1.5 inch thick. The other one, you have to be at 3.5 inches thick before it provides the air barrier. So you have to think about, you know, do you have an, we had an application where we only had 1.5 inches to insulate. We had a drop floor, and between the floor and the garage, we only had 1.5 inches, so we had to go with spray foam because that was the only thing that was available to us with the width. So a lot of different reasons why, you know, you'd want to do it. You can sort of see why it's doing the moisture barrier. As you're spraying it in, it's providing, it becomes rigid. It's providing structural integrity to your construction, as well as that complete the complete vapor barrier. So challenges, you know, if you're doing a remodel similar to before, you need to have access to your bays. This is not something you can do from the outside in. So it's really more appropriate for brand new construction. And it's a professional install. This is not going to be a homeowner install. It's good for new construction. It's excellent for the air sealing or the vapor barrier sealing. It works in a smaller available space. And compared to others, it's not going to shrink and degrade over time like some of the other options that we looked at earlier. So the trade-off here is price. You're paying more for it. And it's not so much a retrograde refit. It's mainly for new construction. And this is the fourth one we'll talk about, foam board or rigid insulation. This is kind of popular. You might see if you go by a house, you might see this on the outside of the house. It's not so easy to see here, but they have taped They've taped the seams between, so this is, by taping the seams, this has now become a vapor barrier as well. Depending on the construction of what that foam board is, the same 1-inch thick board could be anywhere between R1 to R5. So it's important that you understand the R value when you're looking at what you want to do. Cost per square foot, again, it's almost directly related. 1 inch, twice as much for a 2-inch thick. Depends on, again, what are you trying to get with your R value for the cost. The challenges, so I didn't put access to bay here because this doesn't need a bay. So that's one of the benefits. Access to the application, so you need to be able to get to the point where you're going to put it on. Cost, it's a little bit more expensive. It's getting more insulation and a shorter value. It's good for air sealing. It's good if you've got a smaller space. This example, it's not so easy to see. This is a basement, and they've applied the foam board here against the concrete. So there are some foam board that works well against concrete, so you can have the direct application to avoid the thermal bridge of bringing the cold into your basement. And it's also great where there's no bay structure available. So if you think about the other items, they needed a bay structure to hold them in place. This can just go on the outside. So this might be a good thing. Let's say you're thinking about residing your house. So you take all the siding off. You might put one or two layers of foam board and then put your siding back on. That could be a solution if you're already going to be residing your house. It's a nice application for the foam board. So there are four different types of insulation. And now I'm going to talk about not the type of insulation, but the design of how you use that insulation. So this is called a double wall construction. And Dave's got an example in the back. What you can see here is you've got an outside wall, you've got a space, and you've got an inside wall. So the two walls actually never touch each other. What we've got is only cellulose between the two walls. So when we talk again about avoiding that thermal bridge, here's a thermal barrier between the two walls that don't touch. This is a thicker wall. So when you think about what does it look like with your windows, so your windows are probably sitting into a nice window well. They'll be further back. Same with your doors. But it's not so much that it's a very expensive insulation. It's that the design has allowed the thermal barrier to protect you. And so it's not definitely not appropriate for a retrofit. You're not going to build a second wall inside. Brendan?
Well, I think typically studs in my house, they're 2x3s, and now you're going to have a double wall. Can you make it a 2x1.5? I mean, it seems, if you use the two sets of each wall had 2x3s, it seems like a lot of extra heavy.
Yeah, I don't think the building code will let you do 2x3s anymore. Oh. So modern construction is just not allowed. 2x4 is even going out of favor. 2x6 gives you pocket of insulation. That's the R19 she's talking about. That's your average bay.
And so the whole thing is a load-bearing wall then?
Yeah. Typically the outside wall is load-bearing, and that's where your windows are attached to, most likely. The inside doesn't have to be built as strong, so it doesn't have to be load-bearing. The one we happen to have had built for us was, double top plate, all that. Yes?
Could you use the 2x4s or 2x6s sideways?
You could. I've done some of that on construction, like where I wanted to put a pocket door in. I had problems with twisting and such. It's just not a structurally solid unit. You don't have as much nailing. It's not as cross-braced by the sheathing that way. It's all wobbly. I mean, you get wood, you build quick, and you just hope it's straight enough until you get that sheathing on. Not likely. And one of the things you do lose with this is space, or you're building a slightly bigger dimension overall to get everything in there without losing interior space. You don't want your inside walls to be too small.
Yeah, so this is good for new construction and good for the no thermal bridge. So those are the main types of insulation that you can be using. Let's talk a little bit about, we started talking a little bit about building code. So the building code does have insulation requirements. It's not as easy as telling you, it's R19. unfortunately. It's a little bit harder than that. They have a HERS as the acceptable measure. It's called Home Energy Rating System. And there is a piece of software that your builder or architect will have where they put a lot of data in and it calculates a number. And here's just a snippet out of the report for our construction, just to give you an idea. It talks about, you know, every wall, window, ceiling, and what your R values are and, you know, what's acceptable. It adds up a number. You have your number, you have the maximum allowed, and they tell you, okay, you're X better than code, you pass. And so what that means is you could have a really good R-value wall and a crappy R-value window, and you'd be okay. Or the reverse, really good windows and not such good walls, you could still be okay. So there's a sort of a formula that goes along with it. The building code in this aspect changes, and it's been changing a little bit frequently lately. So in 2009, we got an upgrade, and in 2012, we got another upgrade. So they're continually pushing more and more insulation for its additions or new construction. Either one of those.
So if you're just revamping something, just taking something and trying to make it tighter, you don't have to.
No, if you're not changing the structure of the building, you wouldn't need to worry about this. This is when you need to pull a permit because you're actually changing something about your building. But it's just interesting to know, because if you are thinking about adding an addition, some people might not be aware that now there's some code that you'll need to meet that you just 2 years ago you might not have had to meet. I believe this number comes from some calculation based on these. I think that's the maximum allowed, which is the based on the square footage of your thing. They have some internal calculation that says that's the maximum you can be. We were 38% under the maximum, so we're okay. If our number had come out to be 300, we would be over the maximum allowed, and we would be not meeting code. And so the way this number gets calculated, it's based on all the things you've entered here in the secret software that I do not understand. It pops out a number, and you're either good or you're not. If you're over-insulated, it's money that you've spent that the code says you didn't have to, but maybe in our case, we wanted to go super-insulated. So that was our goal, to be over code.
Gentleman was asking, why is there a maximum? Why do they forbid you from putting too much insulation?
It's the other way around. It's the maximum before you are not meeting code. So this is the maximum number. If you're over it, you don't meet code. It's just kind of an inverse of the way you might logically think about it. Yeah. Okay, so we talked about insulation. Now let's talk about air sealing practicalities. So if I remember that the day Dave and I bought a house, it was only a 20-year-old house, but we went down into the basement. It was a bright sunny day, and we could see sunlight all across under the sill between the foundation and the sill board, the first piece of wood that builds your house. This is where you need to worry about your air moving to the outside. This is an example between a floor and a joist, again, of an area where air could be moving outside. Sometimes it might even be up under an area where you can't actually see where the air might be moving outside. Fixing these leaks is going to be the quickest, easiest way to get better comfort. You're going to want to target the things that you have access to. You're going to avoid, you know, pulling off your molding and looking for things around doors. You want to do the things you have easy access to. So think about your basements and attics. If they're unfinished, looking around in there. The seal around your doors and windows from the inside and from the outside. Look at what you can see. Outlets on an exterior wall. So Dave has some products to show you about how to keep cold air coming in through an outlet. Really, what you're thinking about is any penetration from a heated space to an unheated space. Any penetration. So that could be in your attic. You know, maybe you've got a ceiling fan that takes heat out. You know, what happens in the winter with that fan? Is that just a way for your warm air to go up and out? What about a register duct that goes into the basement? How is that sealed? I mean, how is that making sure that your warm air isn't getting out? So any penetration from heated to unheated space is your target for air sealing. And what are your tools? Your tools are a foaming insulator. like great stuff, and we've got a few examples of those in the back. Caulking, good for your windows and doors. And rubber gloves, very important. Never try and use great stuff without rubber gloves. Very bad. So we talked a little bit earlier about professionally sealed homes. They need to consider about air exchanges. If all you're doing is looking for the things that you can find through your eye and sealing those, unlikely that you were doing anything about needing to worry about air exchanges. If you really wanted to do a test, it's the blower door test that tests how tight your house is. And we did have a blower door test on our house. They'll tell you what a goal is for a good house, and if you're over that goal, then you need to have an air exchanger. You need to have something that actively moves the air in and out of the house. Okay, now we move on to the homework section of the presentation. I have homework for you all. So here are your take-home actions. I think you could do all of these actions this week. So tonight, if you're really ambitious, steal one of our great stuff cans on your way out. So we talked about any penetration between heated and unheated space. So I got this off the internet. I'm not sure what the unheated and heated space is, but this is the back of something. And what you can see here is that the foam is making sure the air is not moving around that space. So anything that's accessible, anything that you can see, you can go and do your foaming to make sure that the air is sealed out and is not moving around. The one caution is fire block foam. So if you are going between floors, that would be basement, first floor to second to attic, you can't use a normal foam. You must use a fire block foam to stay within code. And that is to make sure that protects fire from traveling up through that access from one area to another. If you also were part of an apartment, going even this way from one apartment to another could also require fire block foam. So you just need to think about that. Think about your older windows. So you can see down here, here's a guy, maybe in the October, November timeframe when you don't think you're gonna open your windows again, you can put some shrink plastic around. You hit it with your hair dryer, it shrinks down and makes sure that air doesn't move through your older windows. Here's the example with the outlet. You can just for about 75 cents, you can get this little foam piece that will fit over your outlet, and you just screw it down like normal, and it holds it in place and keeps the cold air from moving out from what may be unheated on the other side of that wall into your heated space. For about $2, you can cover up your hose bib. So, hose bib, talk about a thermal bridge. Outside, a piece of metal, freezing cold, going straight into your house, bringing that cold right into your house. So, let's break that thermal bridge, put a little thermal barrier for about $2, and there's some examples of some of those there. And then this one, you can even finish this action before you leave the room. You can sign up for a mass save audit. It's free. They'll have some, maybe even some free light bulbs out of it, but they'll be able to come to your house and help you figure out what it is you need to do in your specific application to get some better insulation. So those are your take-home actions. I will not make you all turn something into me later, so you don't have to worry, but I would love to see everyone do these actions this week. Okay, so let's talk about your resources to help you. So there are a couple programs that can help you. Let's say you want to do a big project. You have it's not something you're going to do at home with a can of great stuff. So the Mass Save Heat Loan is an awesome program. Up to $25,000, zero interest, up to 7 years to pay back. The nice thing about the heat loans, they're focused on energy saving efforts. So let's say you take out the loan now, you tighten up your house, you're paying less on your energy bill, and that's the money that you now put towards your heat loan. So you can sort of keep a level budget and just pay that off, and when it's paid off, you now just have a better insulated house. MassSave has a weatherization program, up to 75% off if you spend up to $2,000 weatherizing your house. No cost air sealing. I got that off the website. I'm not exactly what kind of air sealing that is, but I'm sure our MassSave experts can tell us. Just talked about that. About every 5 years.
The program doesn't deal with the building. But the heat law, the mass heat, it's not just for insulation. You change your, you need a new
It's good for a lot of things, new windows, I mean.
You really want to go to the website too, because it does change. So for instance, just the other day, there's now a deep energy retrofit. So let's say that's putting insulation on the outside of your house and windows all in, top to bottom, $50,000. Wow. If you want to put in a pellet stove boiler, there's some money into that. So that's just adding 0% in 7 years. And if in the process, another kind of thing, because both of these apply to me, if in the process of doing heat loan for something, you have valve and tube wiring that has to be changed out because of that infrastructure upgrade you're doing, or you have asbestos in the way, those are some $2,000, $3,000 grants. They just give you to help you out with those payments. That's just constantly changing. It's not static.
Yeah, that's good. These are actually links. So if you sign up in the back and you checked, I want to get an email copy of this, you'll get an email copy of this presentation. You just can click on these links and I'll take you. Yep, if you put your name back there, I'll email this to you. Yep. So make it a good one if you're going to get a heat loan. So I made the plug for the MassSave audit. If you wanted to have a virtual MassSave audit, you can do an online assessment that'll give you a partial sense of what the actual the audit is like, and it can make suggestions for you on things that you can improve around your house. I thought this one was really interesting. You can tweet a picture of your attic to the folks at Energy Star. These are the folks that rate the washers and dryers, and they will give you some free advice on your attic insulation. I thought that was great. It was almost enough to make me get a Twitter account, but yeah. So Energy in Action, this is National Grid's website. So we, in Bedford, natural gas comes from National Grid. I actually get the newsletter emailed to me. A lot of really helpful stuff in there. It's the latest on what the rebates are. So there aren't a lot of rebates here for insulation. Where you'll see more rebates are on appliances, washer, dryer, boiler, a lot more. And that website has your latest information on any of those rebates. And the articles are helpful. In fact, the one that just came yesterday said, hey, tips on insulating your house. And I immediately went to look to see if there was anything I wasn't including. But it was all in here. It's all in here. You have to have a Twitter account, and you have to tweet a photo of your attic. I just thought that was very unique. This one, Energy in Action. Yeah, this has a newsletter. It has a website. Yep, you can just Google Energy in Action, National Grid. It'll bring it up. And then this final one I used to help me put the presentation together. HomeWise, it's an independent estimate of work that you might get done in your house. It has a lot of different types, but it had a whole section on insulation. So you put in your zip code, how many square feet you want to do, and it gives a breakdown of what you might expect to see in a bill from the average contractor in that area. I thought that was really helpful. If you're thinking about doing an insulation job, it might be good before you start out to guess about how much you'd be spending. So I thought that was really helpful. So these are just some resources. If you get on the web, there are a ton of great resources. A lot of people are just happy to put this information out on the web and share it with others. And so you can Google a lot of stuff. And now that you understand all the concepts from our earlier concept, followed by the quiz, I'm sure you will understand everything. Okay, questions. Any questions before we move to our hands-on portion?
I just had a couple
of questions. Excellent. I believe you have to do the rebate before you buy, but
it was all over the floor in the fire. Everybody else, the whole bottom floor was off.
We can look, but typically I don't know if you can you do it retroactively.
It might be a calendar year thing. It's maybe worth pursuing. Part of it is if you have electric and you go with a hybrid electric, like a heat pump water heater, there's money in the pot for them typically. But if you just replace your boiler with a boiler.
I had to replace it. It was broken. The water was coming out. There was no way to stop.
Yeah. I mean, it depends. I mean, if it was a, you know, highly rated, you know, they have a score on how much energy from the source, natural gas, goes to creating hot water to heat the house. If that's a really high number, there's some money in the pot for that as well. Yeah. You know, these websites.
He was very surprised. He was 14 years old. They said they don't last that long anymore.
Yeah.
The boiler, hot water boiler was 14 years old. He said he couldn't believe it. Yeah. They don't last that long anymore. They don't make things anymore.
Yeah, if you go to the Energy in Action site, that'll have all that information about rebates.
There's not any health issues in terms of the foam insulation.
That is a great question, one that I avoided throughout this because there's only so much time we have. We looked at four different types of insulation as well as looking at things like cost and R-value. It's important to look at health effects. And so there are some that are considered, even in the same rigid foam board. There's XPS, there are EPS, they're very different, not only in the health effects to you, but maybe the health effects to the people who work in the factory that created that foam board. So when you start thinking about all that, great information on the internet you can read through. It's definitely an important consideration when we thought about what we wanted to use for insulation.
And another thing that's common with remodeling is PVC, and that's another, you know, from when they conceive of making it to, you know, getting rid of it eventually. It's one of the worst plastics out there, and we strive as much as possible to avoid it at all costs. It's almost impossible to do it. Electrical wiring, for instance, is clad in PVC. So you do what you can. You try to isolate from you and your kids and, you know, pets and all that. You know, one thing with regards to insulation in particular, you know, I'm liking the cellulose because it's a bit cleaner, greener. There was some need for foam in our plan, so it was added after the fact, but, you know, had to be done, so to speak. All of it was far away from us. All of it, theoretically, is going to be 100-year-plus installation. You know, the whole design and structure that we did, we invested in doing it right first time in the last, you know, century, hopefully. And, you know, whatever that is encapsulated in that foam is theoretically going to be better than the oil or natural gas or whatever that we've put into our house via heat and all the pollution that's entailed there. And, you know, as local encapsulated, like I say, there's always pluses and minuses. You do what you can. It's definitely a personal choice. Some foams are far, far worse than others. For instance, the pink foam shown on there, zero of that was used on our property. Main reason, greenhouse gas, you know, carbon dioxide and all that's in the news and methane. The chemicals or, you know, the things that make the foam kind of expand and kind of pop and do its thing, 100 times worse than, like, good stuff. You know, it's just exponentially bad. So again, you know, that pink stuff, extruded polystyrene, zero. So, the, you know, even with foam, there are some that's like, okay, no way, no how am I going to touch that. But you look, any construction you're seeing, that's the stuff you see. So a lot of people are maybe a little less concerned or don't know. There is some greenwashing in that industry in particular, where the manufacturers are saying one thing and they can't really offer proof because, well, it's all proprietary secrets.
Is there a reliable site to get that information?
Not that I've come across yet. Just really delve into it and do a bunch of research. Fingers crossed. But again, you know, the jury's not out on PVC, the jury's not out on XPS, you know, it's just bad. So those are two that you don't really have to do research, just avoid them.
Any other questions?
Question, with insulating your house, did you go with a hot roof or a cold roof?
So the display we have over here kind of shows both of them, and we ended up putting the vent channel on top of the structure. What that mainly gave us was that just inside the roof was all living space, conditioned space. So it increases the amount of space you have. And it also increased the thermal bridging, you know, was less because of it, and the higher insulation value around that connection, wall to roof, was better because of that. Typical construction, you could totally do and make it work, you know, for your typical attic. You know, you're just not using the attic as little space, conditioned space, in the hot summers and the cold winters. And it just keeps a lot of the heat out in the first place when you put the vent above, because it's allowing that heat that's created hitting that roof surface to kind of dissipate with that airflow before it even gets into the structure itself. So, like I say, I'll point out what the differences are and how it's achieved.
There's a lot of insulation people out there. How do you know who's credible and legitimate?
Again, that's cross your fingers. Even the good ones, you know, they may have some high school kids doing some of the work. You know, what do you know? Without looking over their shoulder all the time, which obviously, you know, is very problematic. You just, you know, sometimes have to cross your fingers and hope it's done right. Seek out the better ones. And I don't know that there's any, you know, way to know for sure other than personal recommendations. I mean, afterwards or later, we can tell you who we used on one case, which we absolutely love and happy to spread the name around. Others I won't mention.
But, you know, I would say have a conversation. So you now have some basics understanding about air movement, about R value. And we didn't spend a lot of time on some of the problem areas like connection points, you know, where roofs connect walls or where corners come together. It's harder to have a thermal break. Have a conversation. Have someone explain to you how they're going to handle, you know, your building envelope. How are you avoiding, you know, thermal breaks? That might help you understand. If they say something that sounds a little wonky to you, maybe they're not the right ones for you.
And again, you know, end of the day, you know the concepts, you can take a look at what's going on. Usually it's not a quick, you know, process and then they cover it. It's taking, you know, days to achieve. And if there's any misses, it might be that you say to the builder, insulator, you know, I'm expecting to get out of this, you know, such an R value. I want to be able to take a picture with an infrared camera. I want to do a blower door test and I want to achieve, you know, a certain number of air changes per hour. So that's kind of saying, okay, we can do that. That's what we do, no problem. Then to have the blower door test it out. Okay, good to go. Here's the final payment. So work that into the contract. I'm sure if it's a reputable company who's looking to do the right thing by you, they're going to be happy to allow something like that.
The heating furnace and the hot water boiler are in a small room. They need fresh air. So how do you feed them fresh air without sucking it in through the other parts of the house?
Sure, and likewise, fireplaces is probably the worst case scenario like this. Combustion air in a direct fire, you know, it's fed on a PVC typically, maybe ABS hopefully someday, tube from the outside. So a lot of houses nowadays being built, you're gonna see through the side of the house two, you know, let's say PVC tubes, because most people use that. And it's literally the intake air going in for combustion and the exhaust air going out. And because it's so efficient, it's getting rid of all of the heat before it goes out, and it's getting rid of all the pollutants that, you know, would typically need to be up and away through the chimney effect. Your normal, you know, older boiler, hot water heater, furnace, fireplace, all of that.
But what do you do for an existing installation?
So if you have an existing boiler, some people kind of close that room down and create air intake for that space. So you kind of isolate it within this construction. You're going to lose some space because, you know, next to these units you can't put wood, fiberglass, you know, insulation. You have to give it a certain distance. Also for serviceability, you're going to want to have some space around those devices. So, you know, when they have to be repaired, replaced, you have access. And the next one you get, have it as you know, direct fed.
Yeah, well, I was thinking of putting a 4-inch dryer vent through the wall there.
Yeah, it should be more than adequate. And again, there's going to be specs on how much CFM, you know, cubic feet per minute, that boiler that you currently have needs.
Yeah, I mean, it's a good question, right? It's showing that you understand you need to worry about how the air is going to move around. If you're moving to the point where you're sealing your house so much that you're going to need to add some of those vents, then you've probably got a professional who's helping you who can help you figure that out. Because if you're going to need to pull in air for combustion, then you're going to have to worry about your air exchanges, which is going to be a different sort of system.
I just had it done previously on our oil burner. We just suck air through the house just like you breathe. And on the new oil burner, a pipe much less than a dryer vent, probably 2 inches as opposed to 4. And the air intake from the outside would be.
You still have a chimney?
Yes.
You vent the oil burner up the chimney?
Yes.
The building code discusses this. When you enclose an existing boiler or furnace, you have to have a intake, which is high, and intake or exit or out, which is low. But have you a certain, you know, so many square inches opening and width, depending on the capacity that you have running.
And obviously, new construction, they're mandating, depending on like situations, we have an accessory apartment, so we have to have carbon monoxide, and it goes off here, the whole house has to ring out as having carbon monoxide. So if you don't have carbon monoxide detectors, that's another thing to do. In this situation in particular, you know, you want all that trapped carbon monoxide in there, you go in there to do something quick, and you know, bang, you're out conscious. So, be mindful of that situation too.
Any other questions? If not, I'd say let's move to our hands-on area. So we've got our friends from Next Step Living who can talk to you about having an audit or some of the other items we have. And Dave can show you some of the specific construction and materials over here and answer any questions about that.
Thank you.
So thank you. Thank you, everyone, for coming. Appreciate your attendance.